Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Lin Tan from Samsudin Lin & Associates, in short, SLA. SLA is a real estate-based conveyancing law firm in Malaysia, dealing with Malaysian properties as well as UK properties. Hence, today's topic on wills is essential, is important for those of you who have already purchased UK properties or are planning to. Now, as a Malaysian lawyer, a Malaysian will consist of most or all the clauses like how a UK will is. And most Malaysians will think that you only need one will, and that's your last will made by a Malaysian lawyer. However, I do urge all Malaysians who have purchased foreign properties to compartmentalize their wills to their different jurisdictions. Being a Malaysian lawyer, I'm also an investor of UK properties. I myself have also made a will for my UK property, just for UK property, and another will for my Malaysian properties. So therefore, with that, I compartmentalize all my properties that are in Malaysia under one will, UK properties under another will. Now, why? I will let Sunita to continue with her talk on the wills in the UK. Thank you.
Thank you, Lynn. Before I start, I'd just like to see how many of you actually have a will. Okay, that's not good. Okay, well, at least it's good to know that some of you do have a will. So thank you for that. Now, I'm just going to ask, I'm sure some of you may know what a will is, but for those of you who don't, I'll just explain a simple version. What is a will? A will is a legally binding document that lets you decide how you distribute your assets and to who you want. In accordance with the laws of England and Wales, a will must be executed in accordance with the Wills Act 1837. So I'm going to run through why it's important for you to have a UK will. Of course, firstly, it allows you to decide how you want your assets distributed and to whom you want to distribute these assets to. There could be a family member or a friend that you don't want, that you don't want them to inherit anything. So therefore, it's very, very important to ensure that this is recorded in your will. Secondly, you have to choose executors. Executors are persons that will be responsible for handling your estate affairs after you pass away, God forbid. And it's important to choose, they can be family, friends, or professionals such as lawyers or accountants. It's also good, a very good idea to seek their permission before you appoint those executors, because not everybody wants the onerous task of handling someone's estate. So you should get their consent before you actually appoint executors. It also gives clear instructions as to who you want to appoint as guardians for children that you have that are under 18. It details your specific funeral arrangements. It also makes it easier for your family at a very difficult time when the last thing they want to be doing is sorting out your estate if you haven't already done so. So therefore, it makes it much, much easier on your family to make sure that all they need to do is, in the unfortunate event, is hand it all over to the lawyers and let them decide, let them deal with the process rather than them having to decide with the courts how it's going to be done. Now, again, it limits family disputes which can arise and which we have seen that have arisen from time to time. So it's, again, a very good idea. It may also help with reducing inheritance tax, which I will come to again in a short while. Now, what happens if you don't make a will? If you don't make a will, then your assets can be passed on, as defined by the laws of England and Wales, to the next of your kin. If you are husband and wife, then obviously, and you have children, then the assets usually pass on to the next of the kin. But for example, if a couple's not married and they've been living together for 30 years and they haven't made a will, then it doesn't automatically mean that their assets will pass on to their partner. And we have seen this happen. We had a client who were together for 50 years and unfortunately he didn't get around to doing a will in time. And his partner didn't inherit everything. It went to his children. And although she had contributed and worked towards their business, she got something but very little. But most of the assets were passed on to the children. So therefore, again, there's a very good reason why you should make a will. If you die without a will in the UK, it's known as dying intestate, which means the UK government will then decide who they will appoint as executors, guardians, and distribute your assets according to how they see fit, and which may not be what you have decided to do, what you may have thought of during your lifetime, but you just simply haven't got around to it. If you die without any close relatives, and you haven't specified that you want your estate to go to your friends or make donations to a charity, then all your assets will go to the UK government or the Crown, which is the Queen. And she's got enough assets, so I'm sure you don't want to be giving her any more. Okay, now that some of you have already completed, I think, or are in the process of completing, you may have been asked, how should we hold our property? Whether we should call this joint tenants or tenants in common. Some of you may already know the difference between this, but what we find from time to time, when we send a questionnaire to the clients, they tend to tick the box as to what they want, but they haven't actually understood the difference. So I will explain what the difference is. If properties are held as joint tenants, this usually means that if, in the event that one of them passes away, the property will pass automatically to the other, and it doesn't form part of your estate. But again, it's important to do a will, because in the sad event that both husband and wife die in a plane crash or any other natural disaster, then if you have a will, the assets will then be passed to your children. Tenants in common are co-owners of property, where they can hold the property in equal shares, or they can decide to hold it in the percentage of their contributions. So if somebody's put in 40% and the other person's put in 60%, you can actually differentiate the share. And we find that this is usually common with friends, business partners, siblings. So it's always according to the amount of money that they put into the property. If in the event that you hold the property as tenants in common, and if one of the tenants passes away, the property would pass according to your wishes in your will. It would pass to the other tenant. So that's why, again, it's important to have a will, because it would record in the will who you're passing your share of your 50% or 40% or whatever it is. I'm going to talk about inheritance tax. Now, this is a subject I know it's close to everyone's heart. Everybody asks us from time to time, how do we not pay inheritance tax? Now, inheritance tax is payable at 40%. In the UK, no matter who you are or where you are resident, anywhere in the world, everybody that owns a property is liable to pay inheritance tax at 40%. The UK government have said that the first £325,000 is tax-free. Anything above that, you'll be taxed at 40%. So for example, this is just an example, of course. If you have an estate value, properties valued at 500,000, the first 325,000 will be tax-free. The difference between the 500 and the 325, which is 175,000, you will be taxed at 40%, which is £70,000, which is a substantial amount of money. So therefore, we always do say that you look at the value of your estates, because there are ways that we can actually reduce inheritance tax. Some of these examples are gifts to family. So if you own a property and you've already completed, what you can do during your lifetime, you could transfer the property to your children. Now, the children, you must survive, when making a gift, you must survive 7 years from the date of making the gift to your children. If you do survive within the 7 years, then the property that you've transferred does not form part of your asset, and it won't be taxed. If for any reason you pass away within the 7 year period, let's say it's in the second year somebody passes away, then the inheritance tax would reduce for each year that goes past. So if it was in the first year, it would be around, second year, let's say, it would be around 36%. And as each year that goes by, it will reduce. Okay. You can make donations to charity. They will be tax-free if you want to. You could set up a trust or a family partnership. Now, I have set up ways that you can reduce inheritance tax. Trusts are a very complicated subject, and these are just examples. But if this is something that you were looking to do, before I could give you an answer, we would need to assess your personal and financial circumstances, and then we can advise you on what is the best structure that is available to you. There are other important considerations also that you should be aware of. Again, as we keep saying, and I keep highlighting this, that it is very important to have a UK law. And I'll give you an example of why. We were acting for a client who bought a portfolio of properties, and they were resident in Kenya. When they passed away, they didn't have a will. And they did have a will in Kenya. So what we had to do was we had to request a copy of the will from Kenya together with a sealed probate from Kenya, which took ages to arrive to the UK. Once we received it, we then had to go back to the High Court of Justice in London to have it resealed and then to get probate. Now, in total, the whole process took over 3 years, which is a long time to wait for your assets to be distributed. Eventually we got there, but there was a lot of to-ing and fro-ing in the sense that what the attorneys from Kenya were giving us, the High Court wasn't happy with. So we had to go back and forth. There were lots of mistakes that had to be rectified before we eventually managed to get the grant of probate sealed in the UK. Again, this is why it's very, very important to have a UK law, simply to deal with your UK asset, nothing else. Because when you have a UK law, it speeds up the time to obtain probate. When we have acted for a client who was resident in Hong Kong, they bought properties. He had done a UK will, thank God. So, when he passed away, we were given instructions to deal with obtaining probate. We were given the instructions in January, and we managed to get probate by May. So it was quite a quick process, and we dealt with the distribution of assets quite quickly. Because nobody really wants to wait for years and years and years until the assets are distributed or resolved. Another thing is, if you have done a will, or if you do, once you've done a will, you should review your will every 5 years, because obviously circumstances change from time to time. For example, you could be moving to a new home, which you may not record in your will. You could have more children, you could have grandchildren that you hadn't already mentioned in your will. You could be separated, divorced, remarried. So these are the circumstances that should be recorded in your will to ensure that nobody has been left out of the will. So I suggest a review of wills is done every 5 years. Another thing I want to mention is some of you may have a Malaysian will, for example, or some of you may not have a Malaysian will. You may decide, because you've just bought a property in the UK, you want a UK will, and then you may decide to do a Malaysian will, and you may think, oh, I'll put the UK property into my will. I would strongly suggest you do not do that, because by doing that, you will cancel your UK will. So it's always best to deal with assets in each country. For example, if people have investments in Australia, US, UK, Malaysia, Singapore, it's always best to do a will in each country, simply because you can then deal with the laws of that particular country. It's much quicker and more efficient, and you could end up spending and duplicating fees, costs, and again, the stress of having to deal with all, having to get granted probate, sending to these different countries. Believe me, it can take years, and it's something that nobody really wants.